And then we did date this summer. It wasn't in terms of how we envisioned dating, but we did date.
Trash.
And
I actually wouldn't know that.
It wasn't, but it did impact us. And there was a lot of lessons. What about you? What were some of the good things that came out of the pandemic for you?
I think the best thing was just reorienting myself towards family and getting reconnected with them. I'm an uncle now. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm very happy about official mm-hmm. uncle. My brother had his first son. Mm-hmm. I don't know how many kids they think were having, but leave that to him. But his first son, Joseph, was born, and that was just like a surreal moment that kind of put me in the mindset of like, okay, manhood, adulthood, like we here. Like, there's no like, oh, you're almost there, or you're like 1 foot in, 1 foot out. It's like, no, you're a man. You're those responsibilities of being that uncle that, you know, puts a little game into little man so that he knows what's going on, to reinforce the lessons that my brother tells him and that Beth, his wife, tells him, to reinstill some of their values while also instilling my own. Like, I think that's what the role of an uncle should be anyway. Like, you can always put in your 2 cents here and there, your morals and all that, but you're supposed to help facilitate, raise that child within the village, primarily supporting the way that the parents want them to be raised. Of course, if I see some fuck shit, if my brother's listening, I'm like, what the fuck is this shit? Because that's what we're supposed to do. We're family. We're supposed to hold each other accountable, and we're supposed to keep each other sharp. You know what I mean? Two T's out here. But that was great. That was great for me. It was a surreal experience, like I said. But it really solidified the fact that, you know, we out here at manhood. We not knocking on manhood's door. We out here setting the table. Nah, fucking. We out here mowing the lawn. We done moved in already. We in manhood mansion. So it just made that real. So that was like probably the best thing that happened. Other things were, you know, making music and paid to be on Curtis King's flow course when it comes to music production. That was amazing. I was so glad for the opportunity.
I'm proud of you, babe.
Just being able to put out my expertise when it comes to talking about anxiety, when it comes to talking about that prefrontal cortex, how it's used, and that relationship and that dynamic between the brain, the mind, and the body, and when it comes to the music and the feeling and the vibration. Those relationships have always been fascinating to me, and the fact that I was able to break that down for producers all over the country, all over the world, in that course, and also be, in the lineup of other people, because he had a whole bunch of, like, professors and academics lined up to talk about it as well. So, yeah, shout out to Curtis, my man Curtis King. Great, great opportunity for me. I'm sure we'll be working again together pretty soon. But there was that. That was great. What else? I had a couple other things, but those were probably the two main ones. Just reconnecting with my family, solidifying that manhood piece, and then being able to create, you know, on that level and share my expertise when it comes to artists, when it comes to mental health and music. You know, it's great. So that was the good. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we gotta talk about the other side. So, what would you say was the hardest or roughest, maybe most challenging? There we go. Most challenging thing that you went through during this pandemic? You know, what was it that probably pushed you the furthest and made you maybe question some things or shake stuff up?
Well, like I said, I had to rethink my life.
Right, that's true.
Because I had a plan for my life, and my plan did not include a global pandemic with months of quarantine. So I had to rethink my life.
You see that coming?
Didn't see it. You know, the mindset 2012, not 2020. How was I supposed to know? I thought we were good.
A couple years off.
So. You know, the numbers sounded familiar. They lost in translation. all right. So the first thing I had to rethink was my career. I had already decided that I wanted to slowly transition out of practicing individual therapy. And once I hit 2 years license, I'm able to supervise, of course, with some classes and shit. But, but yeah, I'm able to supervise. So I was going to supervise associates as well as facilitate groups and then train the associates on how to facilitate those groups too. So that way I just have money rolling in.
Not a bad hustle, right?
Exactly. And that's what I wanted to do to start setting up our nonprofit, you know? So.
Man.
Whew. Exactly. So I had a lot of plans for that, but this pandemic burned me out. Like, I was already burning out of this profession. And that's the thing they don't tell you in grad school, is they will burn you the motherfuck out because you can't survive on this pay.
Facts.
And then you're trying to get as many clients so you can actually get the hours and get licensed. But then by the time you get licensed, you burn the fuck out and don't want to help nobody. Not in that capacity.
So, for all who don't know, we're both therapists. So we have firsthand experience when it comes to the
system.
Not only the system. Yeah, that's exhausting in itself. But just like empathy, like the empathy fatigue that you get when you're dealing with people's rawest emotions, and you gotta understand, like, we're therapists, but we're also going through the pandemic. So right? A lot of times it's like a separation between what we're going
exactly.
through.
Exactly. We've had time to process it, right. You know. We're just experiencing it's not raw for
in
us
real
too.
Time, just like you, like.
Yeah.
So
that, and then everybody's that talking about it.
Yeah.
All of my clients were talking about it for weeks.
It takes a lot.
But it's also telehealth. I ain't signed up for this shit.
Telehealth is probably the most draining shit in the world for me personally. I'm already a digital minimalist. Yeah. I do not like being on screens that much. The fact that I'm on screens so much is pretty much dependent on the fact that I need to put out content, like how I'm doing right now.
Exactly.
You know, that's really it. If I could just be as creative as I am without all the screens and technology and shit, I definitely would be. You know, and if somebody else can just do all that work. But again, that takes plenty of resources. So,
what time?
Soon. Yeah. Soon come. But yeah, telehealth. Then you gotta add on the empathy, the fatigue for the empathy on top of the screen fatigue. Mm-hmm. And it's like, yo, that could take me out.
Yeah.
So yeah, I agree with you on that one for sure. Telehealth was not the wave. That is great.
Yeah, so because of all that, I had to rethink my career because I was like, the fuck? Like, I this was what I had been planning for 5 years. Mm-hmm. The year I'm licensed, finally.
That's when some shit goes down.
And it's like, well, now I have to rethink. And then even because I was trying to get out of this profession, transition out and to do other things that I'm interested in. So I was going to go back to school for child development and African-American studies. So that way I can move further along in the nonprofit and opening a daycare and things like that. But I also don't want to do online classes. I don't want to do distance learning. I know how I learn and it's not like that. Like, if I'm going to go back to school, because my dad definitely taught me from a lesson from a professor that was kind of racist, was that, all you need to do is read the book. Like, the classes are structured around a textbook. So if you read the textbook, you're good. But I know how I learn. And I know I'm an interpersonal learner. I learn through discussion. And especially on topics like African-American studies, as well as child development, like, I need to be in with my people, engaging in conversation and transferring of ideas. And yeah, I need that. And distance learning, no. I know, again, I was in that training for 8-10 weeks. I know how it is. It's different. Call and response is different, touch is different, like, yeah. So, and that's the thing we were talking about in the training too, because there are a lot of clinicians within that training, especially the facilitator. I think she's going for her PhD, shout out to her, Joy K. Madison, hey. But yeah, she was saying like this Zoom stuff is tricking us because it's making us believe that we're socially connecting, but because we're not in person, it's not. Mm-hmm. And we're still yearning for it, you know?
Always.
So, yeah. So I had to rethink that. And where it led me, again, I talked about the sister circles and my mobilization efforts with that. So I think I'm just going to continue doing work with them as much as I can. Because I signed up for that training before COVID for a reason. So, yeah, I'm going to continue doing that. Continue working on my books. I ran into a financial snag, but the book is pretty much all done. I just need to publish it for my first poetry book. So look out. Follow me on IG at Light as a Rock. That's ROCQ with underscores in between. And or underlines? I don't know. What is it? And then Life is Rocky on Facebook to see when I put that out. But,
You remind me of things. You always remind me of stuff. Keep going though.
I also started writing some self-help. So I'm trying to figure out career-wise. Other than that, I would say our relationship. Mm-hmm. Like, we've been going through some stuff.
Routine ain't easy.
We have some ups and we have some downs. I don't know how much detail you want to get into with that. So we started quarantine again. I'm licensed now, so we can start working more on our togetherness. So like we were cooking for each other and getting our finances together and joining those and just joining really, and planning for our future, planning for our family. So that was nice, but in that I kind of lost myself, especially with the lack of space. Because we have a lot more space normally, because we do still have different schedules even though we work together. Mm-hmm. So the lack of space impacted me to the point, especially because I'm very aware that most of my 30s will be having children. And that is an adjustment of identity that I'm just starting the process to accept. And having a solid me is important. Like, I can't lose myself in motherhood. I can't lose myself in my relationship. Like, so finding myself was very important this year in making sure that I always have me and I always know my life. But that was a hard lesson because I went through a lot of things to figure that out. So that was a hard lesson. And then, you know, it was kind of the wake-up call to some of our differences, some of our incompatibilities, and it was a lot to learn. But we're getting through it. Communication, effective conflict resolution, and commitment. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, yo, my neck started getting worse throughout the show. I'm still here, though. There we go.
What would you say is the most challenging part of this year for you?
I would say, I'd probably say the same thing, like the relationship piece. Mm-hmm. So I am the person who needs more space in the relationship. She likes to be around me, mm-hmm. and I like being around her. But I also need way more space, particularly in the morning. So yeah, the pandemic, 2020, it shifted our schedule. That on top of...
We were home.
Right, you know, obviously. It shifted our schedule.
Less clients.
Less clients, more time where we're seeing each other. Even if it's just like passing by all the time. Like it's just like frequent interaction.
Oh, I don't know if you all know, we have separate bedrooms to encourage the individual space.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Yeah, I keep forgetting that. Now everybody knows these things. Yeah. So that's right. Good thing you mentioned that. But yeah, on top of that, like, there was also the issue pertaining to the construction above us. So there was a lot of construction.
Renovation above us, construction outside. Right. Yeah.
So I'm also someone who values their peace mm-hmm. and at least time to, like, if there's gonna be noise, I want to be the one making the noise. Like, I want to be the loudest person on the block, mm-hmm. not someone else. You know, that's just rude. No, but that was very destructive. On top of that, the fires. So there's a
Y'all remember when the sky turned orange?
Well, shit, I think most of our listeners aren't even in Oakland, so.
I mean, you remember when the smoke from California blew all the way across the East Coast?
Right. That's how bad the fires really were out here.
Like, it was terrible. It was really bad. I can't even open your window.
So, yeah, that's some real quarantine.
And it was summer.
Shit.
We don't have AC, y'all.
Real quarantine shit right there. Like, that's true quarantine where you're in the house, you can't go anywhere because you can't breathe outside, so you can't even go for those walks, those cherished walks,
which is what we were doing with quarantine. It was like, all right, we're gonna walk.
And then it was that, like, I like walking a lot, but I also like walking by myself sometimes. Mm-hmm. Now that we're on quarantine, it's like she has to come. She's gonna have to come with me. Uh-huh. But we're taking walks together, on top of the time where I might have been walking alone. You know what I mean?
It's like, yeah, we were taking a lot more walks together. Right. Versus when we were both working, we went like maybe once a week.
Right. Because I, it's not that I don't like walking with you. It's just like now that time is up and increased, which means time walking by myself has decreased.
Gotcha.
So it's a whole bunch of that and balancing all those things. And similar to what you were saying, it's I am my best self when I am aware of myself and how I am treating me. Knowing that I'm neglecting my self-care, which is time to reflect, so that I am aware of myself, will domino to pretty much every relationship that I'm in. So I'll give an example, and this is probably a perfect example of what I mean. So now I feel like I'm way more aware of things. So today I had a doctor's appointment early in the morning, and Raquel, you were knocking on the doors to see if I was ready. I was annoyed by that, right? But I looked at it in the awareness of like, okay, well, why is she doing that? She's doing that because she cares. She wants to make sure that I am early and on time for my appointment. So, but there are layers to all those things. But the first reaction is, motherfucker, if you don't get up out of here, I'm trying to be all peaceful before I go to that doctor's. But again, she doesn't know all that. But I'm aware of those things, and I can like give her a reaction that will create a positive feedback loop within our connection versus falling down the rabbit hole. You annoyed me, so now I gotta come and bring that energy, even though you didn't know that you annoyed me. You know what I'm saying? So it's like that awareness only came from the very fact that I was in the shower and was thinking about all those things. You know what I'm saying? So, but if I wasn't, if I don't have those times where I can think about that, I'm just reactionary. And that doesn't do anybody good within the relationship. So that little example is like, you know, expand on that times however many months we've been locked down.
Hey, mom's done. Sure.
Shit. So yeah, that gets multiplied by all those other events. So like you could just do a little thought experiment and think about how many times those little incidents might have dominoed into something more or escalated into something more.
And then we did date this summer. It wasn't
trash
in terms of how we envisioned dating, but we did date.
Trash.
And
actually wasn't all bad.
It wasn't, but it did impact us. And there was a lot of lessons. God, there was a lot of lessons from it. Hey, it's The Real Family. It's your girl, Rocky.
And your boy, Elsa.
And thanks for being here. If you're new to the channel, be sure to subscribe and click that notification bell.
Right, because subscribing and hitting that notification bell does two very important things. One, it gives you notification on our new content and make sure that you're up to date on everything that we put out every week.
Every week.
And then number two, it helps your boy and your girl out with some money. You know what I'm saying? Let's just keep it honest.
It's so real, baby.
But in all seriousness, this is just like the video portion, the YouTube portion of our content. We are It's So Real
Podcast.
So we have all these episodes just waiting for y'all on how many platforms?
11 different streaming platforms.
11.
So it's up to you to choose.
Yeah, there's no excuses. We on everything. So whatever platform you're most comfortable listening to stuff, your content on, we're right there for you. So look us up. It's So Real Podcast.
And our link tree is available on our YouTube channel. Go over there, find the platform that works best for you, subscribe to our podcast, and hear the full thing, because we have a lot more to say than what shows up on our YouTube channel.
Exactly. With that being said, check out the rest of our videos while you're here.
You know? And be sure to subscribe.
All right, y'all. We'll catch you on the next one. Peace.
And love.
Always.